Welcome to This Is Revolution. My name is Jean Bagelin, in for Jason Miles on this White Guy Wednesday. We are going to be discussing a fantastic topic today. We'll be talking about nationalism and the theories of Ernest Gellner. So before we get to that, before we get our power panel of pasty white people on to talk about this interesting topic, I'd like to invite you to like and subscribe to our channel, whether you're watching on This Is Revolution or you're watching on VarmVlog. Your clicks, your likes, your comments down below are always welcome. Well, the comments aren't always welcome if they trigger Jason, but you know, if you want to leave a mean comment, leave it on Van's stream. Don't leave it on mine. So as I said, we'll be talking about Ernest Gellner. And of course, joining me is our resident deep state expert, Deep State Cuba. How's it going, Cuba?
Fine.
Fine. Just fine.
Yeah. We're running short of the Ewok adrenochrome, but I think that my black market sources can arrange enough of a fix. So at the very least, the officer corps won't start going through withdrawal until, before it gets dangerous.
Well, you know, if you miss your Ewok hit, you'll end up smoking Ewok pelts out of desperation, you know, scraping them up off the floor, all kinds of things. I've seen nasty things with Ewoks.
Yeah, and Wookiee adrenochrome is basically Star Wars methadone. You don't want to touch that, but at least it's cheap.
And speaking of Ewoks, we have the one and only angry Ewok off the left, C. Derek Vaughn. How are you doing, Vaughn?
I'm okay. Happy International Women's Day, yeah. And happy Holly.
And happy February Revolution Day.
Yep. Just a reminder, however, don't ruin commie holidays with your liberal crap. That's all I'm going to say.
So. Oh, well, you know, the tradition I'm told in Eastern Europe is that you bring ladies flowers on International Women's Day and you also share pickles with them. I had a very good friend at university who studied the history of the Soviet Union, Mr. Harun Yilmaz, and every International Women's Day, he would come around and to all the former Eastern Bloc women at St. Anthony's College, he would provide them with fresh pickles, or as they're known in the Middle East, turshu, which is a variation on the pickle. But I believe, you know, the Middle East and Eastern Europe aren't so far apart, except in the Middle East, we make our wrapped things with grape leaves. And in Eastern Europe, you do it with a cabbage.
Also, in the Middle East, you don't give the flowers to the women themselves. You give them to their owners, husbands or fathers.
Ooh, that's a bit of a racism right there. Actually, when I was in Iraq, International Women's Day was a very big day. I don't see it being celebrated that much in the West, but certainly in the Middle East, even among relatively conservative people, they have Women's Day events and all the politicians dutifully come out and celebrate Women's Day. Although I did notice,
it's a glorious celebration of property.
Oh, ouch. talking about socially conservative Middle Eastern countries, I had the great misfortune to listen to Morning Joe this morning, where Mika was telling us all about a very exciting conference that they'd had on women's empowerment with Secretary Clinton and former CIA asset Gloria Steinem, held in that bastion of progressive women's rights, Abu Dhabi, the gateway to the world. I could just envisage this thing, Secretary, all these women, you know, they're fighting for equality.
All of the women are on stage.
Yeah, all of the women are on stage, perhaps. Madame Zelenskaya, or I don't know how they say it.
Zelenskaya
was there too, you know, so it was really a fantastic event. I'm really sad that I was unable to attend.
They would have let you in the building because you're not a woman, but they wouldn't have let you on stage.
Fortunately, I was put out of my misery when my son decided to yell at my Alexa to play the robot version of Baby Shark. So, you know, I did not listen to the end of everything. Well, today, with, you know, all this faffing about that we've done at the beginning, the foreplay, we wanted to talk about Ernest Gellner. So, you know, perhaps we'll go into a bit about who Ernest Gellner was in a bit, but we wanted to talk about him because he was, he died in, I think, 1995. I don't know exactly, but he died in the 90s. But he was one of the leading theoreticians of nationalism during the 20th century. He was a pioneer of a school of thought on the study of nations and nationalism that posited that nations were not ancient constructions, but rather linked to modernity, a product of modernity, which at the time he was writing in the 1960s was not the widely held belief. There were proto-modernist ideas to a certain degree, but there was, you know, many nationalists posited a historical continuity between modern nations and earlier political communities. So I wanted to give, before we get into our discussion, a brief outline of Gellner's theory. So Gellner was a philosopher, and he outlines a lot of his ideas in 1964 in a work called Thought and Change. And he came to the idea that nationalism and nations were a product of an uneven process of global modernization, spreading out from the West to different parts of the world. And he linked the rise of nationalism to the question of linguistic culture in the modern world and how the transformations associated with modernity uprooted old forms of community, village identities, tribal identities, and cast people into this new urban setting where language emerged as a new axis of identity to replace that of the village and the tribe. So he saw in the cities, we began to see this new, increasingly ethnicized or culturally defined social conflict. It was partly class conflict, but because of the large numbers of peasants coming into the city and this melting pot of different cultures, that conflict often came to be framed in ethnic or national terms. And he argued this was part of the nature of industrial civilization. Industrial civilization required a new form of education, a new type of citizen, what he talked about as clerks. And thus nationalism basically came to create nations within the context of modernity. Now he further kind of elaborates on these ideas in another work. I believe it was published in the 1970s, but republished in the early 1980s, Nations and Nationalism, which he defines nationalism in the following terms. And I shall get a little graphic for everyone to look at up here. He defines nationalism as, nationalism is primarily a political principle which holds that the political and the national units should be coergent. In brief, nationalism is a theory of political legitimacy, which requires that ethnic boundaries should not cut across political ones, and in particular, that ethnic boundaries within a given state should not separate the power holders from the rest. So he formulates this conception of nationalism, and basically he argues that modern societies represented this new form of literate culture, and nations were not a product of culture or will per se, but a sociological necessity born out of the nature of modern industrial society. And he divides human history into a kind of stages theory where he talks about pre-agrarian, agrarian, and industrial civilizations. And he argues that in agrarian civilizations, you can't have nationalism because culture is often stratified along class. Literacy, which is so central to modern nationalism, is stratified and limited to an elite who have no desire to impart their literacy on the mass of the population. In contrast, modern industrial civilization is requires people to be literate, and is also a society which is constantly in flux, in change, where social mobility happens, where the division of labor is constantly reformulating itself. And so even though modern industrial societies are not necessarily egalitarian in concrete terms, ideologically, they create this egalitarianism. And we see the emergence of this in this idea of a generic education, what he talks about as ex-socialization, where education becomes this key link between the state and culture. And this leads to conflict as high cultures from the pre-modern era repurposed for modern industrial civilization, leading to conflicts with other cultures. So we see that in his view, although nationalism used pre-existing cultural diversity, they were primarily a process of response to modernization, response to changes in the labor market, responses to experiences with the bureaucracy, where people cast out from their villages in the urban centers had this new solidarity based around language which hadn't existed before. So this is a kind of Cliff Notes version of Gellner's theories of nationalism, which are what we might call the high modernist interpretation of nationalism, and has been an extremely influential theory of nationalism, one which I personally think is has a number of merits to it, but also perhaps reflects Gellner's experience as a German-speaking Jew living in the Czech Republic during the rise of Nazism as well, to his particular sort of approach to nationalism and how it has come to be in the modern world. So, you know, with that kind of brief introduction aside, I want to get people's thoughts on this. Would you like to jump in, Kuba, Vaughn, any thoughts?
I think it's interesting that Gellner has to insist so thoroughly that it's industrial civilization. There's kind of a famous line in chapter 7 of Nations and Nationalism where he says capital, like capitalism, seems an overrated category. So it's important to note that while this sounds a lot like prior kind of Soviet, prior Marxist debates around nationalism. And when I say Marxist debates, we also have to remember that these debates don't really happen until the end of the First International. Marx and Engels don't really have a coherent stance on nations and nationalism. The national question is really something that comes up more in the Second International and then in the formation of the Third and Lenin's answer to it. This book is interesting because it parallels a lot of that, but also is really insistent that it's coming from a different place, that like, yes, my typologies of history look a lot like those Marxist typologies of history, but even though I'm not explicitly saying they're not. So I find that interesting about Gellner. And I think, you know, the particulars of being, you know, a Czech immigrant Jew in Britain in the Cold War probably does play into that somewhat. I also find it interesting that he is of a category of people in the mid 20th century who start off as philosophers and get obsessed with like relatively burgeoning social sciences, because he basically devotes himself to social anthropology, as opposed to the two popular ones now, which is kind of like historical biological anthropology and cultural anthropology. And that really shows up in his theories of nations and nationalism. And he considers nationalism, interestingly, a sociological condition first and then a political condition, which is interesting because it's tied into that theory of social entropy that is, you know, industrial society breaks down these bonds. Again, sounds like Marx, but, you know, it's industrial society. It's not capitalism, damn it. And these bonds, once they start the entropy, tribes either disappear or they become nations. That's what tribes do, according to. There's not enough cohesion in other elements of society to maintain that. But industrial society, not the bourgeoisie, needs general literacy, and that means that there's a general egalitarianism, at least in terms of like, well, we need all the workers to be able to read so they can take instructions. And that would help if we're speaking the same language, and it would help if you don't have to learn a language for literacy that's not the language that you speak, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, I think that, let me take a slightly more empirical view. And I think that the Gellner's description resonates a great deal with kind of my experience as a Pole, Poland being one of the an excellent example of Gellnerian type nationalism, and one of those cases where you have the emergence of the sociological category of nation and then the political project of creating a state to reflect that sociological reality. And the linguistic distinctiveness of Polish from German and Russian, the two languages of its imperial occupiers for most of the 19th century, all of the 19th century, is largely what drives the mass mobilization towards the movement. If it were easier, if Polish were as similar to Russian as, say, Belarusian or Ukrainian, then conceivably Poland might have been more easily absorbed into a Russophone state. Similarly, if Poles spoke German, then it would just be a provincial region, either in a Catholic Austrian, you know, Vienna-centered German polity, or a larger larger German national state based in Berlin. But the linguistic condition was absolutely decisive. And for people whose experience of nationalism domestically comes out of an Anglophone country, that connection between linguistic reality and the sociological project of nationalism is much less intuitive. You have multiple Anglophone states, multiple Anglophone nations, even Ireland, perhaps the most rebellious and most determined nationalist rebellion within the British Empire, was a largely English-speaking people throwing out another largely English-speaking people. Even after generations of the promotion of Gaelic, it survives as own vestige. It's very difficult to will a language into existence when the sociological project is there, but the linguistic underpinning isn't. And those other types of nationalist trajectories don't mesh as clearly onto Gellner's case. A similar point could be about the Middle East, where you have different forms of Arabic of decreasing degrees of mutual intelligibility, living side by side and often bifurcated by arbitrary boundaries, with governments that attempt to foster a state-driven nationalist project, But and this is a case where his argument that tribes go away might encounter some empirical obstacles, because so much of political mobilization, and even outside of formal movements, mass movements and parties, the elite work of politics is based on extended family and clan networks among people who speak the same language. So I think that the he's describing a situation, and he wouldn't be the only one, that is more emblematic of a European experience than it is of a general iron law of history.
Yeah. I think that's for a lot of these mid-century theorists of nationalism, and I, you know, and this is a larger project, will probably cut in both directions, go back earlier and more contemporary eventually, but we got to cover these mid-century guys because they're the basis of the current study. I think we hit that a lot. I mean, one thing I was going to ask you, Gene, is last time we talked about Benedict Anderson's theory, which at first glance doesn't look that different from this, but I think it is. And one of the things that I note about this is that in Benedict Anderson's conception of how this happens, even the language is still pivotal and the linguistic construction is still really crucial. And this happens in a way where tribes fade, religious identities become less important, etc. The problems that I have with this is that, the problems that I see between Benedict Anderson's conception, which is all about like print cultures and the market of print, and this is more about like, well, there's a shared formal education system, but there's a shared formal education system in a standardized language because bureaucrats needed to exist to manage all these capital input flows and these factories. And prior to that, that's just not necessary. And it's not super important that like the Lord and the serf can talk to each other. And that difference seems small, even though they're both tied somewhat into economy, but it actually is kind of a big difference in explanation about how this happened. What do you make about that? Like how strong should we see the difference between Gellner and Anderson?
I mean, I think, you know, obviously they both come out of this modernist side of the nationalism debate that emerges in the 1960s. But whereas I think Anderson is at least attempting to provide a kind of quote unquote Marxist explanation, even though that might be a problematic description, you know, Gellner seems to be, you know, very much on the kind of historical sociology Weberian track of things. And he is very much focusing on it, not so much as an ideological structure, but as a sociological necessity born out of the requirements of modernity. And I think there certainly is something to that, in that, you know, there are certain conditions brought about by the transformations associated with modernity, industrial civilization, as he calls it, that creates this basis for nationalism. And, you know, the key people for Gellner are the intellectuals in the city, right? They are the main actors. So I think Anderson is providing a kind of more extended history of nationalism from a historical perspective, whereas Gellner is trying to have a general theory of nationalism, right, which I think is an important distinction. It is, there may be specific nationalisms with their specific stories, but he's providing this kind of almost trans-historic explanation for the rise of nationalism located in this kind of nexus of industrial civilization and the requirements of industrial civilization. And I certainly think when we look at national movements in particular, stronger national movements tend to emerge when sociological conditions have ripened for them for a type of mass politics to take place.
Well, and I'd like to chime in on something that the chat brought up. We missed the issue of uneven development, which I think is very salient here. The tendency in, to paraphrase Gellner, it's not that nationalism itself is a prerequisite of modernity, but rather that modernity tends towards homogenization. It tends towards the dissolving of the web of local and hyper-particular connections that constrain individuals to particular places and situations, towards freeing them into good liberal market citizen, however you want to describe them, individual level actors that can be fed into larger productive enterprises that themselves have to be more liquid than the feudal structures that are purportedly timeless. It's part of rationalization. And the most rational configuration for the human population in this particular course of development would be a single global nation state with a single global language where those individuals could move through the maximum stage and be put into the place where their labor could be best taken advantage of. What happens under uneven development is that in some places like the UK, where you have industrial civilization coming early, you do wipe out Welsh, you wipe out Cornish, you wipe out Scottish, you wipe out Irish as languages, and to the extent that they could get away with it politically, as ethnicities, to create the one British national project. But in areas where those local bounds persist longer and coexist for a time with the development of modernity in cities, you have the persistence of linguistic variation, which then provides a not only a pretext, but also a practical tool of mobilization for the resisting side and a practical impediment to the dissolution of local particularness. Right. But in defending the local particularness of Poland against, say, the German Empire or Russia or the Habsburg monarchy, you dissolve the particularities within Poland. You don't have a universal solvent creating a single unified humanity that can work at any factory for any bureaucrat, but instead you have that merger of social groups occurring within those historically contingent lines based on an initial distribution of linguistic populations together with whoever has the mass and the power to form that precocious state.
To put it another way, I mean, you know, very simply, if we take the modernist argument, it's not nations that make nationalisms and states, but it's nationalisms and states that make nationalisms, which is something Eric Hobsbawm said. And I would always add to that, that may be true, but sometimes they make the wrong nation. That is, their policies end up consolidating an alternative identity, creating the sociological foundations for a a counter identity, a different set of solidarities. And, you know, obviously within the context that Gelner was raised, that's the Austro-Hungarian Empire, where you do have very much this melting pot in the cities of Germans, Czechs, Poles, etc., and mobilization around ethno-linguistic concerns. But I would also say, for example, you know, when we look at a case like Poland, certainly language is one factor that helped to articulate Polish identity. But I would argue another factor is, in fact, the relatively developed sense of a Polish political identity, that Poland had a state, there was a historical...
A king, a state,
there was a historical tradition of a Polish state. So that Polish nationalism was more articulated than, for example, Belarusian nationalism. I think what's decisive there is a political tradition upon which to draw on.
Well, I think that another way of thinking about it is that nationalism is a new thing that's pretending to be an old thing. And the better it can pretend to be that old, timeless thing, then the more successful it will be at that new thing, at its new unifying, homogenizing business. And there's one other element that I wanted to foreground, which is the importance of language as a technology for social control, for economic production, for cultural production and consumption. And the standardization of language is more than bureaucrats giving orders to workers. It's also the basis of a mass press, of a national level culture that can be shared beyond the vernacular. And without that tool to create and consolidate the Benedict Andersonian imagined community, then it would be very difficult to practically imagine the success of a nationalist project. And that development requires a lot of the components of modernity, things like centralized bureaucracy, mass literacy, the technologies that enable mass literacy, like the printing press. So there definitely is something to the contention that modernity is a foundational prerequisite for what we call nationalism.
But where you start, modernity is going to change the story. I mean, one of the things about this story versus Anderson's story is Anderson's story starts about 100 to 200 years before. Like, Anderson's story is going to get you really going with nationalism in Britain and France in the 15th and 16th century. Whereas Gellner's story, well, the stuff in Britain has to happen first. like until you start having industrialization, which is a British-French phenomenon. And it's interesting because as we're telling the story, it's clear that they're very similar stories, right? Because on one hand, industrialization is driving this, it's driving nationalisms. Nationalisms are in a kind of dialectical emergence with nation states. On the other hand, you have a couple of things that's harder to explain in the Gellner view, even though in a lot of ways I like the Gellner view more than the Benedict Anderson view because it covers more elements of society. But why, according to Gellner, would England and France have done what they did before the need for nationally unified polities for a workforce, but after there's an attempt to standardize the language? So, like, you know, if anyone's ever studied English, you have this. If you study Middle English, which was, you know, right when we get the printing press at the beginning of this time period, I learned Old and Middle English in college, in quotation marks. But as soon as you get a manuscript that's like a few miles away from Caxton's library, it's like unreadable. Caxton's printing press is unreadable. It's like the rules are so different. The word choice is so different. I mean, it's kind of, and just to remind people, we're talking about in a space, it's like the difference between Brooklyn and New York. And it's almost a completely different language. And I think that's an important thing to deal with. I think it does explain one of the paradoxes, as someone in the chat pointed out, that, oh, well, it's interesting that capitalism, and I will both say, Anderson's a little bit more comfortable with Canderson. Gellner's really specific that he's not talking about capitalism tote court here. But what you see with this theory in particular is that it does kind of explain why you might have both a very individualistic ethos and homogenization at the same time, because collective ethos actually tend to be collected towards small units. It's very hard to be a collective ethos towards, like, I don't know, hundreds of thousands of people you don't know. I mean, in a real, like, sense where it's not just an ideology, right? Like, where there's, like, organic social norms and whatnot. So making people feel like individuals is a good way to melt down the differences within the administrative unit, and the administrative unit here is the nation. The complications, though, I mean, we've already talked about them to some degree. It's very hard to explain a lot of cultural nationalisms this way. Poland's an example. I think most of Central Europe kind of follows this pattern.
Baltics, Hungary,
right?
Even the Netherlands. You have that very clear. Even Scandinavian countries, you have a very clear congruency between language and nation and national character. But there's one thing that I wanted to bring up with respect to your comment about how different dialects could be, and how you couldn't even read something that was printed two villages over. People have all kinds of romantic associations with language. It's the stuff of poetry, it's the literal method of our thought, of our inner life. But from a brutally sociological, brutally economic, especially perspective, they're just a whole bunch of different ways of, it's like a gajillion different versions of measurement systems. It's grotesquely inefficient.
And it's a matter of taste.
And yeah, if you, you may favor one over the other. One might say that, like, the metric system has the advantage of a certain arithmetic elegance. And you see over time the elimination of local, hyper-particular, and perhaps very storied systems of measurement with a couple of universal ones. And that process of homogenization, I think the efficiency angle is as important as the social story. There is a real cost to preserving numerous dialects within a single state, even if you don't have a, even if they don't provoke political challenges through local nationalisms. If you consider, for instance, Chinese with its numerous dialect / languages that are not mutually intelligible, that does create friction, all kinds of friction within the Chinese state. And even without any attempt to link those linguistic differences to a particular secessionist political project.
Yeah, agreed. And it's also, I mean, another thing is, China has an advantage there because its ideogrammatic writing system is comprehensible, even if the verbally
you can read, even if the vernacular is not acceptable.
Right.
I think there's a couple of points here. I mean, to go to the Anderson argument, which focuses, for example, on the process of vernacularization, you know, he focuses on vernacularization in Europe and the printing press. But I think what he ignores is that vernacularization during the early modern period didn't just happen in Europe. We see vernacularization in the Middle East, a shift away from high languages such as Persian and Arabic towards Turkish being used, as well as Serbo-Croat, Kurdish, becoming written languages during this period.
Written versions of like regional Arabics, like Masri, Moroccan, etc.
And as far as I understand, a similar process happens in the Indian subcontinent, with a shift away during this period from the scriptural languages like Sanskrit towards vernacular languages. So vernacularization isn't the kind of X factor that explains this shift towards, you know, towards linguistic nationalism per se. I think where I think Gellner is actually strongest is in positing this disruption of modernity, which he calls industrial civilization, but we could
just call it capitalism.
We don't capitalism. Have you could call it capitalism. And when we look at the early phases of capitalism, you know, the English Revolution and the French Revolution, this is where we begin to see, perhaps in not as self-conscious a way, processes taking place that lead to a kind of standardization and homogenization. And this, as development becomes increasingly uneven across the world, you know, this is the model with which to follow, right? This is the model to follow. So a whole load of nationalisms model themselves on the French Revolution, right? A whole load of nationalisms look to German nationalism or Italian nationalism around the world. So we have this one thing Gellner points out, I think in his last book, which I forget what it's called. I think it's just called Nationalism in the 90s. You know, nationalism is not simply a sociological process that takes place within each community, but it is a global process. It becomes a principle of legitimacy. And we see a world of nations beginning in Europe, you know, its early sort of iteration in the Westphalian system, in the concert of Europe, and gradually the rest of the world is forced to be incorporated into that system over time, right? There are certainly, and nationalism represents a kind of contradiction in quote unquote bourgeois liberal ideology, in the sense, as you outlined very well at the beginning, Kuba, from a pure universalist liberal perspective, one state, one language, one people. But just as liberalism does cannot fulfill its own promises in terms of equality, it can't fulfill its own promises in terms of universality. And that universality comes to be mediated through the nation and a global system of nation states, which in progressive historical eras takes over the world in the Americas and Europe, and then with decolonization.
One thing I want to get out on this is that it's not just imposed on the rest of the world.
Right.
You have, because there's a danger in romanticizing pre-modern, pre-capitalist societies and polities, as though everything were fine there, and then the big bad modern West shows up. For instance, specifically Japan, China were very eager to enter into that world of nations as on equal footing. And right. It's very well said that liberalism cannot live up to its own promises of universalism, because the requirements of hierarchy within capitalist production, within exploitation, undermine that universalism with whatever is tactically available to the capitalist, colonizer, imperialist, which is often takes the form of chauvinism, whether racial or civilizational.
Right, which Gellner doesn't deal with so much in the Nations and Nationalism book, and he's actually criticized for not explaining chauvinism. But one of the things I think we do have to deal with that I don't think Gellner does properly. I mean, he mentions Canada and Belgium as multilingual states, nation states, but China, the United States, India, under conditions of nationalism as defined by all the modernists, aren't nations. They do not have historically unified linguistic groups. While the United States did have a linguistic homogenization, sort of, that actually hasn't really happened in China and in India. India's unity linguistically is actually an imperial language, which no one speaks as their primary language. And China's is in a writing system that just is really cool, and that you don't have to, it doesn't really make sounds in all the language it needs and all the languages that can use it. You know, it's comprehensible. I mean, it's comprehensible in Korean and Japanese, who aren't even related languages and don't have the same sentence structure. So like it's I think that's a challenge, but I think it's interesting also because it still fits your point, Kuba. All these polities wanted to present themselves, even in their imperial phases when they were like being open about it, like when Mexico was calling itself the Empire of Mexico, etc. They wanted to present themselves as nations and as nation building projects, even though they don't have any of the characteristics that like typify Central European
model of the nation state.
To defend Gallner on this, he would say that, you know, you have this diversity of cultures existing in the world, like a reality of, you know, many different potential. I think he uses the analogy of garden variety, garden cultures versus wild cultures, right? And the nations selectively use elements of those garden wild cultures to create a garden, right? And I think Gallner would probably argue the question would be, with the specifics to, you know, with regards to language, how some kind of formal compromise can be implemented by a state. There could be some kind of historic compromise between different linguistic groups, as you have in Switzerland, as you have in Canada, where language still has to be pruned. It still has to be made useful for the modern economy, but you can have a multilinguistic nationalism. In a country like India, constructing nationalism on purely ethno-linguistic grounds would be a recipe for disaster because of the political balance and the diversity of cultures that exist in that country. And I think, you know, other elements of shared identity can be used to forge that identity, even the use of a colonial language, which then provides a basis for common communication across a country. So I think language is important, but its importance can mean different things in different contexts. It's possible, even Lenin, for example, makes the note that although the rise of nationalism generally tends towards separatism, there are particular cases where different linguistic groups, different national groups, will seek to forge a future together within a multi-ethnic polity. And he uses the example of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, where out of fear of the Tsar, various national movements cooperate in a kind of almost in what you might think of as a cosmopolitan nationalism, where they are able to differentiate their political nationalism from their cultural nationalism.
Whereas team versus state as identity.
And then you have other cases where nations are imagined in a far more organic way, either racially or in a kind of notion of an imposed culture. So I think within particular states, there can be different compromises on questions such as linguistic diversity. You know, it's often, you know, it's a fight for the recognition of a language rather than the separation of a state. You know, I think, you know, if you went to Quebec, there'll be about half the Quebecois population very much defending French and think French should be respected, but are like, yeah, we'll stay in Canada. We're proud Canadians. We're the best Canadians. Where there are others who are like, screw Canada, we're Quebecois. But, you know, there is a Canadian, there is a Quebecois Canadian nationalism that exists, which is just as genuine as
much the like language. Scottish Britishness.
Like Scottish Britishness. So language is, I think, an important axis to understand, but it depending on context, it is not always the primary axis of nation building.
And one thing that we've missed going over Geller the first time, since he's a liberal or not a pure Marxist in any case, which not a criticism or disqualifying, quite the contrary, he is open to the idea that ruling classes and access to the apparatus of power need not be monopolized by a clique. And one of the demands made by the old 19th century ethno-nationalism is that the linguistic unity be shared between the masses and leaders, that those who govern territory should belong linguistically to the community that inhabits it. And in a certain way, English can play the role that it does in India, for instance, precisely because it's alien to everyone there. So
the same role it plays in Nigeria too.
Yes,
and
exactly.
And this is a stark difference from pre-modern societies, where, for example, the Polish aristocracy and the Polish peasant might speak a similar vernacular, but the Polish aristocracy invented an entirely different sort of ethnic origin, the Sarmatian ethnic origin, to distinguish themselves from the peasants below. And we see this in a lot of
France as well. Franconian myth.
And the in Britain as well, the difference between the Normans.
We are Anglo-Norman.
Normans, as opposed to
the Celts.
We see often class is ethnicized in the pre-modern era.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, like, people from different classes did not see themselves as the same peoples.
Sometimes they weren't. Quite often they weren't, right?
Liberalism, with the rise of capitalism and liberalism,
fraternité,
this is turned on its head. There has to be a people, and the people should be ruled by members of that people. So even if there are inequalities, that people are of the same origin. And even the reactionary, as you see in Anderson, even the reactionary regimes of Europe by the mid to late 19th century are propagating these official nationalisms that are reinventing themselves as not the Tsar, but as the Tsar, as a Russian, where you have an aristocracy in Russia that previously wanted to show itself as cosmopolitan by speaking French, adopting Russian.
And the contours of xenophobia change in an interesting way as well. Whereas before the French Revolution, across all of Europe, the only restriction, and it was actually quite negotiable, for aristocratic intermarriage was religion. But it didn't matter if the lord came from the Galicia in Ukraine or the Galicia in Spain. It was a class appropriateness that meant that they were suitable spousal material. But the idea that somebody would be upset that, like, you have an Italian, you might have a particular dislike for a given cultural or geographic group, but it wouldn't be the kind of my country or nothing chauvinism that becomes emblematic of 20th century nationalism, including in places like the United States.
Yeah, and I mean, America is an interesting example as well, because on one hand, you know, obviously there is a long history of, you know, racial exclusion in this country. But on the other hand, the American Revolution creates, I guess, a nationalism that is in many ways far more inclusive, or at least open, or more universal than, for example, Polish or Italian identity. How would we explain that?
Well, that was my point about how America, like the United States as a polity, even though it presents itself as a nation, it explicitly goes on to try to come up with a civic, what was called a civic religion, although they don't mean it as in like a religion proper. They mean it as in like rituals which codify the revolutionary experience or whatever.
Which is different from France, even. I mean, right. Obviously there's a strong revolutionary spirit in France, but it is intertwined with a kind of north of France cultural chauvinism, which was over the course of the 19th century imposed on the country. Whereas in America, you know, I can't remember who it is. One of those Frankfurt School guys, you'll probably know this one, Vaughn, you know, posits the idea that the American Revolution is the purest bourgeois revolution, in that it, you know, what is it to be American? Well, it's the Constitution and all the cultural paraphernalia really comes later. Like, there's 10% of the country speaks German until, like, everybody goes nuts at Germans during the First World War.
But the thing about this, there's two ironies to this, and this is an idea I'm going to bring up about all these modernists. One, they're actually writing at a time where it seems like nations really matter, but they're declining in importance in the very moment they're theorizing them. We could debate, you know, I do not believe we're actually a post-national world. That's not my point. But we could definitely see that the threat of incoherence from outside linguistic groups actually goes down mm-hmm. in most of these nations. And interestingly, I think, again, the Eastern European experience and the Central European experience is actually very specific here, because that's frozen because of the particular way nation building does and does not happen in the USSR and unleashed after 1992, when frankly, a lot of the rest of the world is over it. The other thing I think we have to ask ourselves about this is we're all hinting around the fact religion still matters in these national constructions, but it's not in this story at all.
Like, yeah. I mean, I think that's extremely important. But, you know, when we talk about religion, that's a very Protean concept, because okay. what religion means today is very different from what religion meant to people, you know, 500 years ago. You know, 500 years ago, it's just a way of life. It's the nature of things. Whereas in many ways, a lot of quote unquote religious movements, they are in effect nationalist movements. What is Islamism other than a kind of pan-nationalism that seeks to create a political unit, a modern political unit based on a cultural unity provided by religion?
Right? I would actually argue that, like, if there's this book by Stephen Bruce, which we're not talking about today, but it's on secularization. It was actually arguing that the only place where you see religion really standing up to secularization, I don't mean religion just completely going away, but a lot of things that we associate with religiosity, like say mega churches or whatever, are actually signs of decline. Like, why do you need a system that centralized with that little pastoral care? Because you're trying to maximize inputs of tithing or profits and minimize cost. And why do you need to do that? Because you're not actually as pervasive in society to run all these little hamlets and stuff. But there's another thing there too, in that in places where you see strong religiosity, it is tend to be tied to nationalism. But again, that doesn't that's harder to explain the origins. I mean, we were talking about Gellner's like Weberian assumptions, which I agree are there, but it's like, well, yeah, but why are you skipping over all the like Weber-Sombart debates about religion and national identity and who created capitalism, et cetera, you know?
Well, writing in the 1960s, it seemed religion was on the decline, right? It's like the height of modernization theory. You have the Soviet Union, you have across the Middle East, it's not the Islamists who are empowered, secular nationalists who mobilize religion in a very different way. You know, for Arab nationalists, Islam was not the universal religion. It was a expression of the genius of Arab civilization, right? It was so, and religion has always been molded into nationalist political projects from the offset for a variety of different reasons. Look at the Balkans. I mean, what's the
arguably difference? It's what trips off at the transition to nation in England and in France. Like, so, I mean, I'm not saying that it isn't part of the story. I'm saying it is. I think we have to look at it way more dialectically than Gellner does. Gellner's a liberal. It's hard to ask him to look at anything dialectically, let's be fair. And one of the things about Gellner for a liberal, it's amazing how much of his apparatus we as Marxists can still kind of understand. And that's because, you know, in some ways it is true that liberalism and Marxism come out of a concurrent movement in response to bourgeois society and capitalism, etc. So I think it's an important thing to think about, but it also, it's interesting how like nationalism now versus nationalism in the period that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. Nationalism now is almost the opposite thing of what Gellner is talking about. Like nationalism has a tendency to break down bureaucratic boundaries, has a tendency to complicate polities, but not actually the administration of their political economy. And that's something that's radically different than in the 19th century. Now, again, it's hard to hold Gellner accountable for that. That's not what he's theorizing, right? That's not his problem. That's ours. But it is interesting to think about, like, by the time you get to the 90s, you're really looking at something very different. And I think we've all said, you know, bourgeois society and the settler nations is a very different thing. And that also what this does in the Middle East is a very different thing. But what I find interesting about that, I mean, you know, Gene, you and I talk about the irony of this all the time. What Islamifies, quote, Turkish society, it's actually a nationalist revolution, right?
Yeah, I mean, Turkey is the most Islamically homogeneous state in the Middle East, and that's because of, quote, unquote, a secular nationalism. Although, what do we mean by a secular nationalism? Well, you know, religious identity becomes racialized in a certain sense. In 1895, 96, when massacres of Armenians were taking place, mass conversion to Islam saved villages. You could convert to Islam and they would leave you alone, right? Or there were cases like that. By 1915, when the Armenians offered to convert to Islam, they still get massacred. I mean, we see a racialization with Judaism. One of my colleagues works on Judaism in the Middle Ages, and it, you know, there's one phase where they're like, we need to convert all the Jews to Christianity, and then the second phase where they're like, shit, now we don't know who all the Jews are. Right.
Right. And we need more property. And we got some problems here. But then we're going to accidentally like kill most of our middle class talented people too.
So religion can provide the kind of ideological frontier of a nation, because it comes down to this. I mean, again, it's like the limits of liberalism. It's like you have a revolution in the name of the people, and then you have to define who that people are. Right. and all kinds of weird cultural traits, which had previously not been very important or had little importance, suddenly become politicized in new ways that they'd never been politicized before. And history comes to be reinterpreted in new ways that had never been, never been conceptualized before. So language is important, but I think Gellner's is overestimating language's centrality to nationalism in general as a theory, right? Because I think getting lost in looking at nationalism as a sociological process, that's something that happens because of changes in a particular society, misses the meta point that it is a global transformation in the way the political order of the world is structured. It becomes the vocabulary of international relations. So it is uneven, right? And if you want to be part of that world of nations, you have to kind of play by those kind of rules.
I think the other element missing from this is going to come up when we talk about Hobsbawm, because one thing that's coming up a lot is people are talking about like Shinto and Hinduism and stuff like that. I am of the minority of anthropologists who think those, to talk about those belief systems that way is a nationalist construction, and to talk about them as religions, Tok Court is also a modernist understanding.
Well, I mean, like, just look at Islam, right? People have this notion of Islam as a universal religion. And obviously you can draw on elements of the Quran to paint it as this kind of universal equality. But for the first 300, 400 years of the Islamic Empire, there was, well, first 100 or 200 years.
The Rashidun Caliphates.
The Rashidun and the Umayyads, they were literally building cities to keep the Arabs apart from the population, and they were treating converts to Islam as second class within their imperial order, right? So people obviously project on to, you know, in the 19th century, Islamic intellectuals projected on modern liberalism and gave it an Islamic coat. Like they would say, oh, you know, the Ottoman Empire should have a constitution, because did you know in the early Islamic community, they didn't have a king, but they selected their ruler, and actually constitutionalism is ours. It's our idea. The Europeans nicked it from us. So, you know, like a lot of these ideologies get, you know, think about ISIS, right? What is ISIS? Yeah, you could say it's Islamic fundamentalism, or you could say all these people coming from around the world to fight for ISIS are doing a kind of like copycat.
Reverse American Revolution.
Yeah, a reverse American Revolution.
They're actually, like, not that reverse, because they were both down with slaves, right?
Ooh, yeah, see. But not racialized slaves. That's the difference. No, it's interesting actually to think about these like pan-ethnic religious movements, but also like Hinduism as part of the national character of India. There's not really even a clear word for that. Religion, and I put that in quotations, not because I don't think, you know, there aren't religions, whatever that means, in India that you could call Hinduism. It's that there's really multiple ones. Like, if you've ever studied like Shivism versus like Objecta versus like Krishnaism, etc., they don't share a whole lot. Like,
I mean, I think that the unity within Hinduism may be similar to saying Abrahamic faiths as a single religious category.
Right, right. And if we had like a pan-Abrahamic empire, then somebody might throw that around. I mean, we definitely see it with the American 20th century concept of Judeo-Christian, which is like, you know, notice it doesn't include Islam. And also, like, if you know anything about the religion, Islam and Judaism seem a lot more alike than they do Christianity. Christianity is like kind of the third man out of the Abrahamic religions, right? Like, it's not law obsessed. It has some
the
theological
of yeah. the religious Marx brothers.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. And so, but that's clearly like a construct post post-World War II to kind of, you know, normalize certain things. And
well, it's interesting, too, to see the category of religion move from a specific confession, a religious confession, a statement of faith in intangible, real, intangible yet real metaphysical entities, right? And that impact the way that you live your life, into a kind of civilized versus barbarian category, where you can lump in faiths that have fundamentally contradictory metaphysics, that into a single team because they are still somehow better than the absence of those, of any metaphysical commitment. And often, right, atheists get it from everyone, right? But also the mere paganism or barbaric practices of the inscrutable foreigners.
Well, and, you know, go ahead.
I think it hit its peak. I think this tendency hit its peak with certain third worldist movements, like specifically I'm thinking of Pancasila in Indonesia, where there's basically like five civilized religions, which have nothing in common. They include Hinduism and Islam, and Christianity gets two seats because of Protestants and Catholics.
Well,
and
they have in Indies, they have Kebatina Islam, where the Quran is just the first rung on the road to enlightenment.
Oh, yeah. And Buddhism is like the last one, right?
Yeah. And then, well, you know, what transforms, what radicalizes.
But if you're not one of these, right? Like, a modernist Indonesian could firmly embrace the pseudo-universalism of Pancasila and be absolutely horrified that a Marxist might not believe in God.
That's
right. Well, you know, and also, you know, pre-modern religious communities are often pragmatic, right, in terms of their approach to religion. There's a story from, you know, the Ottoman Empire where there's a Orthodox village and they're being plagued by vampires. So they call in the Orthodox priest. He can't deal with the vampires. So they go, let's try the Catholic. They get the Catholic in. He doesn't do it.
Okay, and Jews and gypsies now. We're at Jews and gypsies.
So they call the sheikh up and they get the sheikh to come and chase off the vampires. But they don't convert to Islam. It's like there's a kind of way of life. But in modernity, I mean, you see this in the mid-19th century with Islam, with the rise of pan-Islamism, which there is an attempt to forge a unity, an Islamic identity out of Islamic communities that historically had been at odds with themselves. Al-Afghani is a Persian. He calls himself Al-Afghani precisely because he doesn't want to be tarred with the Shia brush, because for the Sunni, the Shia is perhaps worse than the Christian. At least the Christian is a person of the book, whereas the Shia should know better and is actually the greater threat to the Islamic community. But there is an attempt to build a pan-Islamic community in response to very specific events, to the polarization of a sociological polarization in which you're seeing the implementation of legal equality, which for Muslims seems like a loss of their traditional status and privilege, and also economic changes that, although not benefiting the mass of the population, are benefiting like a high profile, small elite of Christians who act as intermediaries between the West and the Middle East. And this helps provoke Islamic, the reinvention of the Islamic identity, which becomes in different components, a critical component of specific national identities.
Well, actually, this is something that is interesting to tie back to the idea of the demonstration effect, right? Like there's, to a certain extent, since the end of the Arab Golden Age, Islam has lagged the West in different ways. And you have this repeated cycle of rejection of Western innovation, followed by its indigenization and the reconstitution of fundamental authentic Islam with those lessons absorbed. It's actually very dialectic.
I mean, I would put it a slightly different way. I mean, I don't think before the, you know, 16th century, there is any major difference between Islamic and Christian civilization. And there is obviously interaction between both of those things. I think ultimately the quote unquote failure of the Enlightenment in the Middle East is a political question. Very specifically, at least in the case of the Ottoman Empire, you can see the Ottoman Empire as a Renaissance state, right? Look at Machiavelli. He talks about the Ottoman Empire. Look at that architecture. They're building domes like 5 meters bigger than the domes in Italy to show that to win a bet, exactly. But I think what you have in the Middle East, and I take this from the work of Baki Tezcan, that in the Ottoman Empire, you have a conflict between absolutism and a kind of constitutional populism. And science and modernity and innovation becomes associated with absolutism. So when the absolutists fail, when they lose political power, so too are a lot of the political, the kind of cultural and political innovation that takes place. So when, you know, the populists basically destroy the observatories, stop the flying experiments. They're like, we shouldn't be doing all this fancy stuff. It's associated with absolutism. Now, obviously, that's not the only factor. I think also the Ottoman Empire was not a part of the big economic changes brought about by the Atlantic trade and
Russia's an interesting paired case because there too, to the extent that you have Enlightenment penetration, it's through the enlightened despotism of Catherine the Great. And you'll have popular, mobilized, enthusiastic, and you know, one could say democratic movements that want to destroy all of the printing presses and shut down the schools for girls.
What happened in Persia? The Safavid state collapsed. That's what happened. They collapsed. People, just so people know, Persia...
That's a hinge point. Safavids on the moon.
They collapsed. The Safavids, they had to play in the big leagues. Like the Ottoman Empire had a population of 30 million. The Mughals, I think, were like 100 million. There were only like 6 million people in Iran, and they had to fight wars on two fronts all the time. So I think they eventually got tired. And then, yeah, a bunch of Afghans turned up, wrecked the place up. They did have a revival under the most based Shah of all times, Nadir Shah. Why is he the most based Shah? Well, number one, when the British and the Dutch got too cocky with him, their back doors were desecrated in the presence of the court. He also looted the entire Mughal Empire, which my family participated in. I would just like to let people know that the Bajalan clan were there looting Delhi. And the best thing about the looting of Delhi was that they set up a meeting between the Mughal emperor and Nadir Shah. And they set it up in such a way that they did this thing called Taaruf, where they made the Mughal emperor say, oh, please take all of my jewels and treasure. You know, you're my guest. And Nadir Shah's like, no, second time, no. And he goes, no, I insist you take all my gold and treasure. And then he took it all and then gave everybody 3 years off from a tax break. But then he went a bit bonkers. He killed his son, blinded his best buddy, and everything fell to bits after that. So
it's because Mossad time traveled back to poison.
Mossad, exactly. That's what it's all about, man. Mossad time traveled to get back. But yeah, so basically, I mean, that was way a distraction.
Totally. I was about to say, you could tell which one of us studies politics from Eastern Europe perspective, which one of us is a nations theorist of the Ottomans and Middle East, and which one of us actually is like a literary scholar of South Asia. One of the things I want to put in, though, and it's actually shown up in the comments about these religions, I saw, for example, someone asserting, well, didn't Buddhism come from India? India did not exist when Buddhism as whatever that cluster of belief sets are, because it's mini.
I think Spencer, who's in the chat somewhere, I think he mentioned the earliest question of the Hindu question is whether it's different from Buddhism. And in fact, that argument has been replayed in Islamic studies over mm-hmm. whether Islam was a heretical sect of Judaism.
Or a heretical sect of Christianity. That's also a common one.
I mean, I think the consensus...
Or a very, very poor understanding of Hellenistic paganism.
Exactly. I mean... Yeah, I think the general theory now is that the Quran was written in one period of time. I think the advocates of Hagarism as Islam as a Jewish sect.
Offshoot.
I think that's been debunked. But what we know as Islam today is not what exists in the time of the Prophet or what exists in the early Islamic Empire. In fact, much of the classical thought of Islam comes from the Abbasid period.
Right.
So you know, like that is, you know, these religions are always in flux and change. For example, we talk about Yazidis, right? One of the interesting theories I've read about Yazidis is that, you know, people talk about them as this kind of like pre-Islamic sect. There are some scholars who argue that in fact, Yazidis were originally an ultra-hardcore Islamic sect who basically got chased up a bunch of mountains because in addition to killing crusaders, they also started massacring Oriental Christians. And the Muslims were like, yeah, you shouldn't be doing that. And it's only later that they became heretical. They came to adopt a whole bunch of beliefs that is regarded as heretical within Islam. So these religions are often...
Yeah, Druze is another one.
So. There's a similar story that could be said of the Khmer Rouge, right? That they were driven into some inhospitable and very remote terrain and brutally traumatized by the U.S. bombing campaigns against their joint positions with the Vietnamese communists in Cambodia. And under those conditions, it's something that's very difficult for us to imagine. Right. What happens when you and 40 of your closest comrades, co-religionists, brothers, whatever, buddies, have just seen 100 of your closest buddies brutally killed by terrifying foreign enemies, and now you're living in remote conditions, you don't know what's going on in the rest of the world, you're eating bugs. What happens to the ideology that has sustained you and that brought you to that point? The ones that survive will get weird.
Yep, and then they're also very convenient to funnel money to if you're the U.S. to fight the Vietnamese. But
and you don't like glasses wearers.
Yeah,
exactly. So we're all gone. One for three. Yeah, the Varnes,
I wear glasses.
Varnes
too.
Playing ahead.
Yeah. I've seen people on Twitter use glasses wearers as an insult, which is kind of interesting.
Are they like proto
super tankies? I call them super tankies.
Is it code for
something else? Or
is there Khmer Rouge apologists?
Like, I mean,
there are
Khmer Rouge apologists on that.
Of all the people of all the communists you could possibly be an apologist.
And they don't like the Vietnamese because they're revisionists. I mean, like, out of all the communist regimes, like, I have, like, probably the Vietnamese I have the most. They're, like...
Them and the Cubans.
Them and the Cubans are, like, the most defensible.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So, one day I'm going to have to, like, do a cargo cult study on what happens to political ideas with people who are highly alienated, adopt them on the internet.
Cargo cult study or cargo cult experiment.
Well,
I think we have
an
idea
for
a series, gentlemen.
Oh, yeah. Pol Pot wasn't based. I think there are people who think Pol Pot was based.
Pol Pot was the basis.
Pol Pot was a coward and a bitch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The minimum.
I mean, at least Stalin was personally courageous, but Pol Pot had very, very, very few redeeming qualities.
And he spent his time fancying around Parry.
And he took money from the Americans and lived in a hammock.
Yeah, so what I have learned is French communism plus mountains plus massacre equals CIA? all right, that's gonna get comments. So I guess we've kind of tied down on Gellner, and I think the next one we're gonna cover is Hobsbawm, who I think actually deals with some of the things we're talking about in the last half of this, about the invention and revigoration of tradition. And that's actually where my interest from this was, like, literary studies around religion. That's sort of what my way back when I was an actual academic was about. I found Hobsbawm really interesting because once you get into invented tradition, you realize the whole category of religion is actually kind of a modern thing, that, like, being able to say that as a confessional belief set outside of a confessional belief set of a state of which you were embodied and have a community and social roles, and you don't even think of it as something you could adopt against. And when you do, you're actually actively rejecting your society in a way that we don't consider it. And in fact, linguistic studies have indicated that, like, the recuperation of religio for religion actually postdates the use of secular. So we didn't really even start referring to religions as religions all that commonly, particularly other than Christianity, until we started talking about secularization. But yeah.
Neo-tanky. Well, you know, to be fair,
there are trot tankies.
Tankies are actually revisionists, because it was Khrushchev who sent in the tanks.
Right.
So tankies are actually revisionists who denounce Stalin. Can we just discuss about the fact that someone managed to convince the Stalinists that on Twitter that
Yashov was photoshopped in.
Yashov was photoshopped in, and that Stalin doesn't fap. I'm pretty sure Stalin fapped.
So I'm just, again, weird cargo cult dynamics here, but when people call themselves Marxist-Leninist, I no longer have any idea what the fuck they believe.
It's Marxist-Leninists. Like, it's like Bolshevik Leninist or Leninist is usually a trot. Although they will call themselves a trot from time. They will call themselves trot.
If you call a Leninist a Trotskyist, they're not going to get too mad about it. Like,
but the Stalinists really don't like being called Stalinists. They like to be called Marxist Leninists. So I think we should respect their preferred noun.
But also Khrushchevites and Brezhnevites and Maoists and everybody but Trotskyist or social democrat.
Yeah, I mean, like I'm a Hodgerist. Enver Hodger, he's my man.
You're a Hodgerist? Oh my god.
Juche Hodgerism.
Juche Hodgerism, exactly. That's where it's at. We gotta have more love.
You are too beardy to be a Hodgerist. You are aware of that. Like,
yeah, you're more of a mountain Albanian.
I assume. Let me just check when Enver Hodger was born. Enver. Hodger. How the fuck? Oh, there you go. Hodger. Enver Hodger. There is a whole load of, like, Enver Hodger fans out there. So, you know, he fought the revisionists, that's for sure. When was he born? Okay, when was Enver Hodger born? Come on, Wikipedia. Does it not say on Wikipedia? He was born in 1908. Yes, he's named after Enver Pasha. He's literally named after Enver Pasha. Like, because Enver Pasha, there's a whole bunch of people in the Middle East called Niazi and Enver, because they were the two heroes of the 1908 revolution in the Middle East, in the Ottoman Empire. So he is named after another great Middle Eastern leader, Enver Pasha, who bungled the invasion of Russia and murdered the Armenians for it. Well, to be fair,
Enver Hoxha, however, would have executed you for saying that because you're beardy. I just want to remind you that Albanian communist outlaw beard.
Exactly. Because it's a reactionary type of facial hair. See, Koopa doesn't wear a beard.
I am.
Yeah.
I guess I'm only partially reactionary, and then Gene has just...
You're hedging. The only thing in the middle is yellow stripes and roadkill.
Well, what's his name? Koopa only wears a beard when he's been unemployed for like 6 months. Then he looks like he's just come back from Siberia.
Yeah.
Well, on that note, we have stopped talking about Gellner. Next time, I think we're going to talk about Hovswam. We don't know when. Next time is not the next White Boy Wednesday. We do these nailing it down supplements once a month. White Boy Wednesday can be any number of things.
Hushism.
We should do a deep dive onto Enver Hoxha and discuss his fierce defense of the legacy of Joseph Stalin and his subjugation to the Maoists.
Yeah. Also, the bunkers. It was like central planning for fallout shelters. Crazy.
Wise, given Albania's situation. It could get it from either side.
Well, so that's fair.
Oh, look, we got a super chat. Thanks, JB. Really enjoying this series. Keep it up. Yep, these series do degenerate after we've talked about the subject because we will meander off on different subjects. But we've got a lot of people to cover. I hope we'll cover Hobsbawm. I want to cover John Brulee. Anyone else we should cover? Koopa? Any other important theoretician? Eli Kadori.
Kadori, sure.
This is a little, it's a little bit of somewhat off theme, but I wouldn't mind a coda where we cover Kimlichka and multiculturalism.
Yeah, that'd not be a bad idea, actually.
Why not?
And who's the other Central Eastern European modern scholar who has a name I can't pronounce?
Miroslav Bosch.
Yes, there you go.
Miroslav Bosch is my guy, actually. That's the guy I use a lot of. I use a lot of his work. Him and John Brulee are the two main guys I use on nationalism.
Yeah, because you had me read him, and I was actually very... I was like, oh, this is actually kind of useful, and I haven't read it.
Miroslav Bosch's newest book from Verso is really funny because he just like takes a big, as Pascal will say, a big steaming dump on most of the theoreticians of nationalism, saying that they're just writing words to get tenure. Basically kind of says like they're just talking bullshit, and it's kind of like lame. Hoxha is really good as well because although he points out his theory is only for Europe, I think it can be quite well adapted to other parts of the world, especially taken with the insights of combined uneven development and how, you know, things outside of Europe don't necessarily go in the order that you might expect them. In fact, that's my if anyone is in London in mid-April, I'm giving a talk at the LSE at a conference on Kurdish studies where I talk about combined uneven development and Kurdish nationalism and how Kurdish nationalism actually predates the emergence of a Kurdish political movement. Stay tuned for that one.
That's interesting. The only dicks other
to Armenians does not constitute nationalism.
It does have things to do with being dicks to Armenians.
this weird ethnic detour aside, the only other thing that I would add to the list that we didn't mention is I think we do have to, for our commie brethren's sake, cover the Otto Bauer, Anton Pana, Cook, Stalin debate.
I think we certainly do. I think definitely we need to do a good cover on that. Maybe a couple of episodes on Marx on the national question, and then the second international debates on it, and then go into how it all degenerated with decolonization. And here's one for everybody. Stalinism is not Marxism. It's a developmentalist project, and it's a better developmentalist project than the liberals offer because, you know, they do it better. It's the reason the Asian developmentalist state exists.
Even that, the non-Marxist ones tend to base didn't
the Japanese copy Crip some stuff from the five-year plans?
Yeah. The anti-communist South Koreans did too, actually. Yeah,
exactly. And if you want to develop your country, it's going to be messy, but they're going to get you there because look at China, look at India, look at Cuba, and look at Haiti. Where would you rather live?
Cuba.
Yeah, Cuba, definitely. Like, definitely didn't want to live in Haiti. They don't have any tea.
The liberal developmental model doesn't work and has never worked.
Yeah,
we invented it because it doesn't work.
Yeah, precisely. That's why it's so popular.
Yep, actually.
The only thing that could possibly overthrow it would be a model that worked even less well.
Yeah, Stalinism is a means. Yeah, exactly. Because they kicked out the foreigners and didn't listen to them, they did a better job, because the last thing you want to do, like, I'll give you a story. I was at a development conference in Iraq maybe 10 years ago now. And they had this guy from the frickin' State Department come and give a talk about agricultural development in Kurdistan. And he's sitting there telling us about, like, well, you need to open up your agricultural market to international competition, and you need to remove subsidies. And I was like, that is literally not what you do in America, right? It's like literally the opposite of what. Don't come here with your silly advice, which is like, which, you know, like the thing is, it's like, it would
do what we did when we were on top, but while you're not on top, so that we have an advantage in the game.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, come on, dude. It's like, shut your borders up. Don't pay the foreign loans back. Suck it up for a bit, and then do a China and
a United States, because that's what we did. After our revolution is exactly what we did.
You can just look at the 1998 East Asian financial crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Malaysia was the one country that didn't let the bankers just take their money home and trash the entire economy. And I remember Mohamed Mahathir was the economist, which was normally so proper and buttoned down and wholesome. They really got their blood up. He was Hitler for them for like
years. Yeah, because he wasn't paying the money back.
They were constantly prophesizing the utter meltdown of Malaysia as economy and society. And then the entire conversation just vanished 5 years out, when it was clear that Mahathir was right and everybody who took the economist's advice was absolutely poisoned.
You've got to play chicken with him. You've got to say, we're not going to pay it back. Do you want to send the gunboats in?
Yeah. We like gunboats, right? They're good target practice for our suicide bombers.
Yeah, go for it, buddy. Go for it. Running amok. I believe that began either in the southern Philippines or in Malaysia. So
Malaysia.
Yeah, Malaysia, truly Asia. There you go. That's the advertising campaign. Didn't they try and trump up some charges about Mohamed Mahathir, about him like doing some sodomy or something? Or
no, Mahathir trumped up some charges against Anwar Ibrahim.
Okay.
Anwar Ibrahim, who is chosen. It's fucking Shakespearean. I actually would like to write a tragic play about Malaysian politics. I won't get into it because I don't want to spoil opening night, but
Malaysian
fascinating,
Hamlet.
Fascinating on a personal and political level.
So that's fun. And that is all, folks.
Go for it. Anything you want to say before we go?
Yeah. There's a lot of talk on stuff. I'm doing a symposium on the strange death of Trotskyism sometime in the next month with a bunch of former Trotskyist, so you guys should look out for that. And we're going through on the other Nailing It Down series. I'm actually going through all the sociological theories of class and the different sociological schools that are adjacent to Marxism that we've kind of forgotten about, but if you remember, make certain debates make more sense, like the German historical school and people like that. So if you're interested in basically scholarly arcana, but don't want to deal with it from boring ass universities, then you can come to my channel. What are you guys doing on Bad Boy Wednesdays?
I don't know. We'll think of something.
All right.
We'll think of something. And with that, I guess all there's left to say is we are out.